Dobré odpoledne, milé kolegyně, milí kolegové. Dovolte mi, abych vás přivítal na tomto setkání Akademické obce Masarykovy univerzity při příležitosti výročí 17. listopadu.
Good afternoon, everyone. We'd very much like to welcome you to this afternoon session of the academic community of Masaryk University on the occasion of the anniversary of the 17th of November.
17. listopad je nejvýznamnějším univerzitním svátkem v roce.
The 17th of November is the most important university celebration, is perhaps the wrong word, but event of the year.
A zároveň je to den v roce, o kterém bych řekl, že je to takový bittersweet day.
And it's also of course a day which is not so much a celebration, but also a very bittersweet day.
S dnešním dnem jsou spojeny jak vzpomínky velmi tragické, tak velmi radostné.
With the 17th of November there are memories which are very sad, very tragic and also very joyous.
Ty tragické jsou spojeny především s událostmi roku 39, které jsme si dnes připomněli také v Praze u Hlávkovy koleje. Je to den spojený s pronásledováním českých vysokoškoláků.
The first reason for the holiday is, of course, the 17th November in 1939. And today in Prague, this was celebrated officially by the nation, as it were, at the Hlavkovy kole, at the residences of the students in Prague, on the occasion of the universities being closed down in the country by the Nazis in 1939.
Když mi dovolíte být trochu osobní, já jsem vlastně dneškem skončil takovou osobní pouť po místech paměti spojených s obdobím okupace a univerzita.
Some personal notes on this today. He's had his own pilgrimage to places connected with the tragic events and related to the university.
Byl jsem se podívat v Mauthausenu na připomínce obětí z řad univerzitních profesorů a zaměstnanců. Byl jsem samozřejmě několikrát na Kounicových kolejích, na naší právnické fakultě. 8. května jsme obešli všechna tato významná místa.
They've been in Mauthausen, where many of the professors of the university and employees of the university were executed, imprisoned and executed in the Second World War. At the student residences here in Brno, where again the executions were taken place in the Second World War, at the law faculty, which was the headquarters of the Gestapo here in the Second World War.
A na všech těch místech jsme si připomínali vlastně roli, kterou mají a musí plnit univerzity v dobách, kdy je ohroženo to, co je pro demokratickou společnost nejdůležitější, a to je svoboda, rovnost a solidarita.
And at all of these places, they recalled the what is most important for the universities in times when values are being threatened, and particularly the values which are essential for a democratic society, which is freedom, equality, and solidarity.
A samozřejmě s těmito hodnotami jsou spojeny i ty radostné vzpomínky. Byť se dnes ta vzpomínka na listopad roku 89 stává pro část české veřejnosti trochu ambivalentní, jak o tom svědčí právě probíhající demonstrace na Albertově, která je organizována skupinami, které se dívají velmi skepticky na hodnoty, které my hájíme.
And of course, with the 17th of November, there are also associated these very joyous and happy memories from 1989, with, of course, the exception of some segments of this society, for whom today, in fact, are holding a meeting at Albertov in Prague, and look very skeptically on the changes since 1989 and the values which we feel a university should be defending.
Přes tu ambivalenci, ale je toto den minimálně pro univerzitní veřejnost den radosti, den vzpomínky na začátek hnutí, které mnoho z nás přivedlo do světa, o kterém jsme do té doby jen snili, světa, ve kterém lze svobodně debatovat protichůdné názory, světa, ve kterém lze bez omezení číst knihy, kritizovat ideologie a provozovat vědu, která bez takového prostředí nemůže existovat.
But despite all this, for the university community, it is a day of joy or celebration, because it opened to all of us, not only us in the university, but to the society, the kind of opportunities that weren't there beforehand, the opportunity to openly debate and discuss issues, the ability to hold ideas that were not popular but could be defended, the possibility to do research openly in whatever field you wanted to, and carry on what a university should be here to do.
Ale jak jsem říkal na začátku, je to bittersweet day. Vzhledem k tomu, co se stalo v uplynulých dnech v Paříži, bych vás chtěl teď poprosit o minutu ticha, nejenom za oběti toho pařížského útoku, ale konec konců i za ty oběti toho 39. roku.
Just a minute of silence.
Děkuji vám.
Thank you very much.
Tak nyní je mojí milou povinností přivítat mezi námi absolventku Masarykovy univerzity, paní Kateřinu Valachovou, ministryni školství, která nás krátce osloví. Paní ministrině, prosím.
It's now the great pleasure of the rector to introduce to us, to call up onto the stage, a graduate of Masaryk University and the present Minister of Education in the Czech Republic, Kateřina Valachová.
Vážení studenti, vážené studentky, milí hosté, jsem velmi ráda, že tady dnes mohu být s vámi.
Dear students, dear guests, I'm very pleased that I can be here today with you.
Brno jsem nevybrala náhodou, nejenom kvůli tomu, že Masarykova univerzita je moje alma mater, ale také proto, že mě oslovilo téma, které jste si k dnešnímu vzpomínání k 17. listopadu vybrali.
She was attracted to Brno not only because it is her alma mater, but she felt that the theme that we had chosen to mark today was a theme that was very close to her own feelings and interests.
Je obvyklé a většinou si připomínáme tu radostnější část vzpomínek, právě rok 1989, kde studentské hnutí bylo úspěšné a kdy jsme spojili s tímto dnem naděje o demokracii a svobodě.
Usually it's normal to associate the 17th of November with this day of 17th of November 1989 with what the students who led the changes accomplished and brought us to this situation of freedom and that we have now.
Méně se vzpomíná a diskutuje o roce 1939 a o oběsnění, které následně bičovalo náš národ.
Less frequently do people talk about the 17th of November 1939 and what followed and what it meant for the Czech nation.
Tady ten plný sál je důkazem toho, že tehdejší oběti studentstva nebyly marné.
This full auditorium today is proof that the sacrifices of the students then were not in vain.
Jsem na vás velmi hrdá. Jsem na vás velmi hrdá.
Ještě jedno?
Jsem na vás velmi hrdá, na všechny.
Especially hrdá. She's very proud of all of you.
Jsem hrdá na to, jaké ticho zaznělo po zhlédnutí dokumentu.
She was very proud at the silence that followed the documentary film that had been shown before this.
Slyšeli jsme svoje srdce a srdce obětí.
She sensed her own heart and the hearts of the victims.
Studenti jsou důkazem a vysoké školy to mají za povinnost, aby už nikdy nebylo mlčení.
Students are a proof and this should always be that there never again will be silence.
My tady dnes mlčet nebudeme, budeme diskutovat, budeme si připomínat, co se stalo.
Today we're going to remember, we're going to talk about what happened and discuss issues.
Přes všechny emoce, kterých jsem plná po zhlédnutí dokumentu, stejně jako vy, jsem jako ministryně školství velmi hrdá na to, že studenti hájí spravedlnost a právo stále a věřím, že v České republice jsme v tomto ohledu zcela v bezpečí. Chci vám za to moc poděkovat.
Despite the emotions that were experienced, she's very sure that the students will be a guarantee, in fact, of the future.
Stejně jako váš rektor cítím velkou souvislost dnešního dne a připomínek toho, co se stalo v roce 1930 a 39 a během války i se stávajícími brutálními teroristickými útoky ve Francii.
Like the rector as well, she sees this very strong link between what happened in 1939 on the 17th of November and what is happening in the world today in these brutal attacks.
Platí pro nás to stejné, nebudeme mlčet a nebudeme se bát.
The same applies now as applied then. We are not going to remain silent and we will not be afraid.
Děkuji vám tedy do třetice všeho dobrého za minutu ticha a za uctění památek obětí ve Francii a jsem velmi ráda, že tímto způsobem si moje alma mater a Brno připomínají 17. listopad. Děkuji vám.
Once again many thanks and she's very proud again to say that she's the way that her alma mater and Brno are celebrating this marking, perhaps is a better word, marking this day. Thank you. In the name of the Alumni Association of Masaryk University, the Association of Friends and Graduates of Masaryk University, SAPMU, Spolek Absolventů a Přátel Masarykovy University, I would like to thank our first introductory speakers, and I would like to thank all of you for coming here for this event. Exactly 1 year ago at this, in this very same place and this very same time virtually, we had the alumni organization SAPMU organized its first freedom lecture. And we had two wonderful hours with František Janošek, who had a very rich and very extraordinary life between the wars, in exile, in the war. And then after 1968, of course, in Sweden, founded the Nadace Charta 77, the foundation to support those who were prosecuted under Charter 77, spent the rest of the communist years smuggling material in and helping dissidents. His wife also spoke, Anna Kohlmann, who also had a very rich life and a very engaged life, just like her husband. I think we all left feeling moved and inspired. Immediately, the association, the alumni association, said, "What will we do next year? We must make this an annual event." And we, of course, from the beginning, realized that it was going to be the year of the end of the Second World War. And in the beginning of this year, as the new city administration in Brno was coming up with this idea of a year of reconciliation, the idea emerged that perhaps we could mark the occasion by bringing together individuals who represented, if you want to put it this way, the two halves of the great tragedy of the Second World War, that is to say, the Jews and the Holocaust, and the Germans, because it was also the destruction of what had been one of the most progressive nations in Europe. It was an extraordinary event. It was inexplicable for so many reasons. And eventually we decided that the best way to do this would be to bring it down to the personal level. And so we got in contact with various people who in their own lives or in the lives of their families had experienced this double tragedy, if you want to put it, of the Second World War, and who have had to deal with it, or felt obliged to deal with it, which is not all that common in many cases, and who have tried to move forward from this situation that they found themselves in and that they felt personally linked to. And so we were very lucky to find two very interesting people to come and talk to us today from Germany and from Israel. And I would like to ask our two guests to come up on stage now. Yeah, here we are. Tal Basham to come up and Rainer Höss to come up on stage now. So, to be very formal. It's very hot here, sorry. You may see a gradual striptease as the evening goes on. She's already begun. She's already taken off her jacket.
But that's
right?
It.
That's it. Okay, no more. Sorry, we talked about this and we said, is it going to be all solemn? And we said, probably not. This is meant to be an informal discussion. It's meant to be an event in which our two guests will interact and will tell their personal stories. Will perhaps, hopefully, have more general thoughts and comments to make. And, of course, the second half of it will be open to discussions, to questions from the audience, and so on. So what I would like to begin with is just a very, very brief few minutes from each of them in which they explain their own personal situation, how in their own families they experienced this tragedy of the Second World War. So, would you like to start, Tal?
Yes, hello. I actually have a blessing in Czech because my mother is from Prague. So, dobrý den. Jestem moc ráda.
No.
Že tedy mohu být dnes s vámi? Yeah, something? Okay. Next year I'll speak Czech. I thought we decided that we introduce ourselves just a bit.
Just a bit.
So I am the daughter of Ruth Bondi, Prague-born. She was sent with her family to Terezin ghetto at 1941 and then to Auschwitz-Birkenau. And from there, she was sent to clear rubble with workers in Hamburg, and from there to Bergen-Belsen. She was released in 1945. She came to Israel in 1949. She became a journalist and an author, well-known, also researcher of the Holocaust in the Czech Republic, or in Czechoslovakia, and she and her friends from Czechoslovakia, the Jewish people who immigrated to Israel as Holocaust survivors, built a memorial center called the Terezin Center, which I'm a board member of now. We are all second generation, My father was also a journalist, so I'm a double cross journalist, and I'm a journalist myself since 1980. And I dealt with this subject of the second generation of the Holocaust since I remember myself and since I started working. I was the first to publish some material and articles about it in Israel, about the second generation feelings. And today I think it's a historical day for me in many levels. As far as I've dealt with the subject and worked for Beit Terezin and wrote about it, I never thought that I would meet anybody who belongs to the perpetrators. So we'll talk about it later. But I just will add that it's very symbolic. I was born, my birth date was December 18th, and that was the date of my mother's future gas date. Yeah, so what I'm saying is none of us are just, we're all carrying symbolic feelings towards this subject from our very first day.
That's fine. I think that gives a very good picture of where you're coming from. And Rainer, if you could also give us your quick look at your background.
So, I'm the grandson of Rudolf Höss, who runs and was the founder of Auschwitz, the place where Tal's family was mostly of them exterminated.
All of them except one. Yeah.
Yeah. In a way of an industrial way. So it was the first step for a genocide, which the next step was the atom bomb. So, and I grew up in a family which the ideology was still inherited. So they never moved out of that ideology. It was part in the family. But after the war, mostly of the Germans, they never talked about it. It was a silent growing hate inside against allies and against Jews, and it's still alive until today. So in my family, when I stepped out in the age of 15 and left my home, I never looked back. So I canceled the lines to my family in 1985. That means in an age of 19 years, I completely quit all lines to the whole family and start to interact against them. Well, they, until today, live in that... In the good old times, like my grandmother said all the time. And I want to, for me it was a must to quit this red string in my family. Not to get influenced by that virus of, like, to be an Aryan, to be a master race. And I started to make my research now 30 years ago. And in 2009, it was a public hype. I not expected, and I not want to have it. When I was the first time at Auschwitz with the third generation of survivors and people like Thomas Harding, maybe some of you know him, he wrote the book Hans and Rudolf, How to Capture the Commandant of Auschwitz. So we were there and it was a disgusting moment for me and a very horrible moment, but I was not aware how many hate came against me. I'm third generation. I was not born 20 years later when my grandfather was hanged at Auschwitz, 1947. But people still believe that these families never changed their minds. So my grandfather was a Nazi, so I had to be a Nazi too. But that's not true. I'm absolutely the opposite of everything like that. And so I trained my four kids and my two grandchildren in the same way like I live today, not starting hate, not seed fear in public ranges, work against and help to change the world, to make it a little bit more colorful like it is today.
Okay, thanks very much, Rainer. And I think one question that maybe occurs to a lot of you, and it was one that occurred to me, and in fact it was a question that Tal suggested she might like to comment on. How did she react when we said, would you like to meet the grandson of the commandant of Auschwitz? What was your reaction? How did you deal with this?
I must admit that At first, I was a bit reluctant, and actually, my first reaction when I saw the name Höss, I drew away from the email. It's something, you know, so deep. When I saw this name, and I thought to myself, I don't want to get too close to that. But I spoke to my mother, who is the Holocaust survivor. And she said to me, usually it's very interesting to see, at least in Israel, sometimes the first generation is more logical and to the point than the next generations about the Holocaust. And she, of course, reminded me that you are the grandson, you know, you weren't alive then. So, and we thought that, yes, okay, let's do it. But I must admit, it's not easy for me. Basically, though Rainer appears to be a very nice person.
we spent yesterday
friendly.
Evening in a pub.
She only knows me half a day.
That's enough. But the thing is, I think also that you are very experienced through these years in dealing with the subject with survivors, while for me it's the first time to meet anybody from that side. Even though, of course, not the Nazis, but nothing related. I mean, but you know what I mean. So it's very interesting for him, and I think it's demanding in a way, because you know, in the back of your mind, you still have everything that you have, and if you will talk about what we, you know, inherited, even without words, you know, at home, then. You will understand that, I mean, the relationship with Germany, with Germans, etc., even without words.
It's very strong, and it's
I can give you one small example. I don't know if this is something that you want to go by your
this should be
questions, but one of the questions you said we would talk about is, had we talked about the Holocaust at home, etc., so apart from my mother not passing the horrors at all, just basic, very light stories like smuggling cucumbers in the bra or, you know, very light stories. It sounded like a summer camp sometimes in her stories. She didn't want to burden me. But somehow all of us, second generation, we knew something with Germany was really... Sorry, I'm after a cold. And so the word Germany, even as a very young child, and I told my colleagues here that I was sent to Canada for a few months when I was 10, and I didn't know the language that well, and the school announced that there is a plague or whatever, a disease of German measles. German measles, I don't know how you call it in Czech, but it's... Not deadly.
It's a child's disease. Yes. It's a children's disease.
But when I heard German measles, as a 10-year-old, I knew I would die because it's German, you know? And I called my mother to tell her that goodbye because it's German, you know? It's a German citizen. So, and then I would ask myself, where did I get it from? I mean, nobody talked to me about it. But this is how it was. And
these are these silent things that are silent but present in families.
Yes.
But it must have, you talked about, so Rainer is the first person, as you say, from the other side you met. You must have had also, the first time you met a survivor from Auschwitz, it must have been a strong experience, or what?
Oh, yeah. It was shattering me. I was not aware what happens, if it will be a friendly meeting or an unfriendly meeting. But I got the hardcore version. It was in the film Hitler's Children, so we traveled to Auschwitz, to Birkenau. And there was a group of students from Israel, so they do it two times a year for 3 or 4 weeks. They travel around with a survivor and get back the history. So when I saw these young, proud Israelis walking with their Israeli flags, and I said to the producer, wow, what did they do? And they said, yeah, they have a ceremony about the Holocaust and about... The family members they lost in the Holocaust. I said, would it be possible to join in to see what they're doing? Yes, of course. So we went in. I was standing on the window side. And after a few minutes, I listened and heard my name. So I was really shocked. And then the teacher asked me and said, is it possible to come on stage and to answer questions of the students? So and now you're standing in the opposite of 500-600 very proud Israeli students with flags, and you have no clue, no idea what will be next. So I was aware maybe they beat me up or something like that. So I was more than nervous. And then it was starting a very, very unfriendly discussion on the beginning, but it ends up in a way it was unbelievable for me. So it was also I'm not an emotional person. I was not trained in my family to be emotional. Mm-hmm. So don't cry, don't do anything to show people that you have emotions. And it was the first time in public for me that I couldn't stop crying. And I saw these young students in an age between 16 and 21. And it was unbelievable, unforgettable how everything works in that way.
I want to add something that following what we spoke about, the mere fact that we are here together, I think, is a symbol to what we're talking about. Because we both had to overcome something, at least I speak for myself, in order to do it. So that in itself, I think, gives a message to what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. Also, I thought when I read about Rainer before coming, and I saw a short video of election.
Never forget to vote.
Never forget
to Swedish
vote.
The Swedish youth.
And over there you say, I'm Rainer Höss, the grandson of... Yeah. And I thought to myself, and I still have the shivers, how hard it must be to say these words. And I thought to myself, I don't envy this guy at all. I mean, it's easier to be second generation to the victim than third generation to a perpetrator of this magnitude. It's so hard to go in the world and say you're this grandson of this person. I mean, I appreciate that. You have courage to do so. Because many of the second and third generation never speak about it. They never come out to the open.
That's the problem. Exactly.
Could you say a little bit about this? I mean, how you've both said that you grow up not knowing very much about what happened, you knowing nothing whatsoever, basically. Indeed, like I suppose many Germans at the time,
spoke.
You spoke, but you said like your mother didn't talk too much about the negative side, if you want to put it right.
No, it was negative, but not horror stories. Yeah.
So what I was wanted to move on to was to this stage. When were you? How old were you when you as it were learned the really horrible part of what went on?
I was 15, and I was in training to become a cook and a waiter and a pastry, which was later on my profession. And on my free day, I think the microphone...
No, it's okay. It just slipped a bit.
And I think when I came home on my free day from work, it was the first time that I saw two books on the bookshelf in our home. The first one was The Commandant of Auschwitz by Martin Broschardt. And the other one was People at Auschwitz from Hermann Langbein. He was a survivor of Auschwitz, and he knows my grandfather very well. He was one of his writers in his head office. So I walked by, and I saw that book, and I want to grab that book out, and my father came out of his office like a blizzard. Slapped on my hand and said, these books are nothing for you to read. He took the books out of the bookshelf, placed it in his own home office, and that was a restricted area, so it was not allowed for us to go inside that office without permission. So I was completely confused, went down to my mom in the kitchen and asked her and said, why I cannot read these books? And she said, okay, let's wait. Your father will move to a meeting to Sweden. That's why I have a very, very close connection to Sweden. And then you get the chance to read that book. So everything was done. My father left to Sweden. My mom gave me the books, and I read it in 2 days. And after I'm finished with both books, I packed my suitcase and moved that house forever. And I never looked back until today. It was so horrible to get the real facts about him, about my grandfather, and had the knowledge that my own father lies about it. and glorified him. He made a statue out of him. Like a wow, what a behaved soldier, a good guy. He only follows order by order. No one who only follows the order would establish such ovens in that amount, in that size. I don't know how many people of you were or visited Auschwitz. And when you see at the Shona, the lousing ovens, they are small against normal ovens where they burned and cremated the victims, the people. So he established it and said, we need more capacity. So 2,000 a day is not enough. We will have 12 to 15,000 a day. And that was, for me, it was horrible. Then it became in that age of 15, so I went out of my home. I have nothing in my back, so nobody protects me. I was by my own. And then I fled into drugs, into alcohol. And what I not expect was my boss. He was a product?
Product?
A product out of a breeder home. I don't know if you know what it means, a breeder home. Mm-hmm. In Germany, we have the name Lebensborn. Mm-hmm. It was a blonde, blue-eyed lady and a SS soldier, blonde and blue eyes, yeah. Were connected. And in that moment when the lady was pregnant and the baby was born, they took the baby away and let them grow up under the rules and conditions of the SS. So they had no love, any warmth, any family, any things like that. They were rough, raw, and cold. This was the next level of the SS. So it was planned by Heinrich Himmler. And he was my boss. So I had no clue that he knows who I am and which dark legacy my family inherited. And he took me under his wings and said, okay, I will help you to grow. And he was that guy in my life who bring me on that path I'm today. And I grow and grow and grow, and I found daily new things about my family, and that's the task I'm dealing with.
In fact, he was your second real father.
Yeah.
Real father.
And he passed away last year.
Wow.
It's
after cancer, yeah.
Because I discovered horrors also, but not on that part. This is, as I said, even more horrible to think that someone in your family did such things. But I think the first time I discovered the rough truth was that we had albums at home of these terrible, terrible photographs, you know, of the bodies that my mother hid. She worked in the AP, a journalistic agency in Prague before she came to Israel, and they collected these pictures, and she kept them. And I looked at them. I was young, and of course it was horrid. And from the age 16, I began to
insatiably
all the time to read about this subject. And as many second generation children do, imagine what I would have done in this situation. It's one of the real symptoms that you think, what would I have done, you know? And the other thing is, how did my mother survive this? And should I talk to her about it or not? In my 20s, my whole generation, it's the beginning of the 80s, while we didn't talk when we were adolescents, during the 20s, many, many second-generation people in Israel started to write literature, journalism, etc. And that's when, you could say, we came out to the open. And my little voyage was to interview, for the first time, second-generation children who, until then, kept quiet. We never talked about it within our peers or at home too much. And since the mid-80s, I think we really started dealing with it and discovering things. And I thought I'd talk about it later, but my mother did write books. She wrote her autobiography, and there I discovered, for instance, that she was married before my father. And she wrote about the Elder of the Jews in Theresienstadt, Edelstein. Mm-hmm. It's called The Elder of the Jews, the book. And there I learned what I needed to know about the Holocaust for the Czech Jews. And then I joined her here in 1990 for the first time. So that's the other part, visiting Theresienstadt, etc. So we'll talk about it.
Just to pick up on that, because you're talking about then how slowly you, as a second generation survivor or daughter of a first generation survivor, came to how did you come to deal with this? I mean, when you
psychologically, you mean?
Psychologically.
Well, now we know that there is a second generation syndrome. You can't go through such traumatic experiences without inflicting on the next generation. Sorry, and as I told Rainer yesterday, they have research done now that it even going through very hard experiences, traumas, can inflict some mutations on your DNA that goes to the second generation. There was a research about it published now, sorry. And so we all have some things in common, which we all know about in Israel. And it goes from not upsetting your parents because they went through such a lot, so you have to be good children, not make any trouble, no adolescents, kids, problems, not them, to food issues, not to throw food, finish all the food that's given to you because, you know, sure, they would not throw food, to overprotectiveness on some families, to guilt feelings in others. The interesting thing was that our parents hoped that we would have nothing of that. They were hoping that they would build a new generation, a new healthy...
No complexes, nothing.
No complexes, sun generation. My mother used to say, this whole second generation thing is it's a money for a psychologist. You know, they want to make good money. So it's an invention of... But regretfully, she admits today, it's not so. And of course, as I said, it's impossible that it would be any other way. And the interesting thing is that it also appears in the third generation, mm-hmm, for the good and for the bad. My two children, especially my daughter, deal with it a lot. My daughter is an actress. She's 25, and she's writing a play now with her friends, third generation children, about the Holocaust. Sorry. But they use also black humor, which is their way of dealing with it. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about it.
Okay. Yeah, interesting. This, of course, in Germany, there was a generation that came up in the 60s, the 68 generation, saying, you know, what did you do in the war, Daddy? And this was really the first time, as far as I know, when there was this widespread public open questioning about what went on in the war. But how specifically did it then affect, I will say, people like you? I mean, you were born later and so on, but people who then wanted to talk about their families who were very complicit in things, let's say not just ordinary Wehrmacht soldiers and so on, but people who were linked to people who had committed really great atrocities. And do you meet with some of these people? I mean, do they have similar experiences to you? How do they deal with it as well? Or do they deal with it?
I met Niklas Frank. He is the grandson of the governor of occupied Poland. And he was the guy who creates the Warsaw and the Krakow ghetto. So his wife was a believer, mm-hmm, in all that stuff. She said it was the biggest warehouse of the Nazis, the ghettos. So she went in to get some of the, what do you call it, like brass or special clothes, where the Jews were very good in things like that, mm-hmm, for sizzling and all that stuff. So she went in... And let the people said, okay, you prepare it for me, so you stay one day longer. So you're still one day more alive. So he's the only one who is on my level in Germany who helps me to fight against. And, of course, he made it a little bit longer while he is another age. He is second generation like you. He is, yeah, the son. But he only acts in Germany. And my way is I'm acting global. So this year, I have over 80,000 miles by plane and 250 schools this year. So, and the year is not finished. right now. So, and to deal with that legacy, I think it became some the last 5 years like a profession, like a passion, to see how many things we can change to telling that story. People call me an opportunist and said, okay, I will make money with it. Believe me, if I would make money, I live off the pension of the state. That sure. is how much money I get out of my work. Mostly of what I get is my private money. So I sold my company 12 years ago after a stroke and 6 months of coma. And it was clear when I awaked out of the coma that my life has to be changed. I called my partners and said, I will sell you my shares. I will get out of that stuff, hunting money down, making business. For what? Money, we need money, of course, to live. But money is not all. I think education is more important that things we had in the past not repeats in the future in the Reiner. Present.
We have to talk about, we said we talk a bit about, values and, things that, before we talk about the future, which is a big part of what we want to talk about.
We can get to that in a moment. I'd like to return, though. Why do you think, you say you're the only one from one of these sort of major Nazi families that is going about, and or one other person, the grandson of Frank. This seems, it's obviously, it's a very difficult thing to do. But I'm a little bit surprised by it in the sense that I think Germany as a country has done far more as a country to deal with its past and what happened in the Second World War. Most of the other countries in Europe where there were various degrees of collaboration and so on have just sort of said, let's draw a line and not talk about it.
But all the stuff they made was by aristocrats, historians. So the younger generation is not really interested to read that very dry books.
So my question is maybe a little different. Why do you think that there are perhaps not more
from the Nazi families?
From the Nazi families who were willing to come out and talk about it and deal with it?
I think it was that's the ideology which were delivered mostly of mom
but
and dad
Eichmann's,
and grandparents.
Eichmann's son, one of the sons came to
Ricardo.
Ricardo. This I remember. Just one son.
It's only one time. And he said, okay, I did it. Finish. Mm-hmm. So we had a lot of these grandchildren and children who said, okay, they made their outcoming and said, okay, I'm...
It's but very it, hard.
That's it.
Yeah, okay.
But it didn't change anything. Mm-hmm. I think we had to make a reflection to the people.
You know, it's interesting if you think about it, that it was not so easy to be a Holocaust survivor in the 50s or 60s, at least in Israel. They weren't accepted that well. They were thought of, the people at the time, the young Israeli nation, did not look favorably upon them as people who didn't fight, you know, who went to the massacre, who didn't give a fight. So, and they weren't talking about it. They weren't asked and weren't talked about until the beginning of the 1960, the Eichmann trial opened the subject. And I think for the first time, the Israelis then started to understand more about what was the Holocaust, because people were in Palestine at the time and did not really understand what they went through. Also, my mother told me, she took the number from Auschwitz off her hand. She went through a little operation and took it off. Because people, used at the beginning, she said, used to look upon her suspiciously as though she had done something wrong. Like, what did you do that you survived? What did you have to do to survive? Maybe you gave some services? Mm-hmm. What services did you give that my family...
Like a collaborator.
Sort of collaborator, a suspicious person.
So she, as a journalist, decided that she wants to be the one who questions, not one who's questioned. And she's one of the only three Israelis who erased their number. And when she's asked, she said she doesn't need the number in order to remember Auschwitz. Mm-hmm. It's in her head. So that's
this was presumably something in the reverse sense that was going on in Germany in those years. I mean, let's move ahead, let's rebuild our country, and let's not talk about this.
There was this movie now about the Berlin trials, Munich trials, the prosecutor. Bauer?
Fritz Bauer, yeah.
That he tried to bring Auschwitz people to trial.
Right.
And nobody collaborated with him.
No.
Right?
He was a traitor. He was an enemy.
When are we talking about, roughly?
A movie.
Yes. No. When was this happening? These trials, or when he tried to?
It was 1961. It was the last. It called the Frankfurt Auschwitz trial, and it was the last trial in Germany, where they get Nazi guards and people who were involved in mass killings from Auschwitz on trial.
And it was unsuccessful, you say, basically. Yeah. So this, as we said, it was really only in the 68 generation and then in the 70s that people really began questioning. What effect did that have then on the society? What greater awareness was created, and how was there, if so, how was there greater awareness created then? Because, I mean, there has been a radical change in German society in the last 50 or 60 years, especially compared to any other society in Europe. In terms of looking at its past and trying to deal with its past, what happened there from 68 on and in Germany? We'll sort of move on to this a little bit now.
I think that the Germans, they wrote a lot of books, they made a lot of research about it, but they not inherited the Holocaust as their identity. It is part of our German identity, and we have to accept it. We have to live with that burden the next 100 years. So
I think they felt very uncomfortable for the fact that they lived so close to it and didn't see or hear about or didn't want to know,
That's why I made the difference.
And they felt so uncomfortable that they didn't want to deal with it afterwards. Not talking about the big perpetrators like your grandpa, but just regular Germans.
That's why I go this way. So when I passed away, I don't know, I hope I have a lot of years. So, but I hope I let something good back of me.
For sure. I would like to add, when you asked what changes were made, I think in the Israeli society, there was more appreciation of the bravery of private people that did not mutiny, but the fact that they kept some human values in face of the horror, or solidarity, or stayed with a mother or with a child, even though they could have escaped, that's bravery in itself. So they started to appreciate what they call the bravery of the lonely person, of the human soul person, not the big mutinies, not the big fights, but just to keep yourself alive and with hope and survive. And I always say that I admire my mother so much and her generation, not only for surviving, but keeping the human values and then building a new life, a new profession, new life, new family, and still staying optimistic, you know? And this is something I took with me very much. I mean, the fact that, first of all, just to say thank you for little things, for life itself is the big present. And the second, not to lose hope ever. Because, you know, I always remind myself, she reminded me, you know, that finally she survived, even though she went through, she's, you know, was 32 kilos when she left Bergen-Belsen. So never to despair. And also, well, that's another story if we talk about the Islam. God, she resigned from God. If you ask me, her and myself, I mean, we don't really believe that there's some you know, charm or omen or something that would look after you, not really, you know, because it was opposed to all logic what happened there. You know, you could one day think, oh, I'm so lucky, I said this, I had this cameo, the next day, you're gone. So no logic and no nothing. So these are values, I think, that we learn to appreciate through the years.
Some sort of humanistic values, perhaps, rather than religious ones. If we look at the other side, if we look at the German side, You sound very skeptical about Germany having learned anything, but you know clearly Germany now is a very different country than it was in 45 or 50 or 68.
Of course it was.
How do you think this has changed? What has changed, and how has it changed?
I think it starts now. The change starts now with the,
as late as now.
Yeah, with the. So we prepared, and I told you it yesterday. So I was a part of. Together with some lawyers, to start a new trial 50 years after the last Frankfurt Auschwitz trial. And it was impossible to establish a trial in Germany.
You mean for a Nazi perpetrator?
Yeah, right.
How old is he?
He is 93 years old. Ah. And we got a lot of bad, bad emails. How can we take that guy on trial? And he's so old. But he had a luxury life. He had a good life. And what happens to the victims?
What did he
do? To the survivors.
This guy?
He was the accountant, the bookkeeper of Auschwitz. So he collected the money from the deportees. So, and he said in the trial, it was very easy. So I opened all the cases, put sometimes 16 to 70 and 80 different currencies outside, the jewelry, the gold teeth. So I put it in several boxes and send it one time a week to Berlin. So,
what sort of this is happening now or just recently?
The trial is finished, and he was sentenced to 4 years imprisonment. But in that age in Germany, nobody goes in jail.
Okay, what was the discussion around it now in Germany? I mean, in newspapers, in the media, and so on.
In Germany, it was quite silent about it. So not a lot of newspapers were there. They were there, but they made not the really? Big hype out of it.
But you know, I was under the impression that Germany, and especially in the Angela Merkel time, takes real responsibility. For instance, when the Arab Prime Minister Netanyahu mistakenly made the Mufti of Jerusalem responsible for the Nazi ideology, she came forward and said, "No, it was us."
Right.
And I think it connects to Germany's attitude towards the refugees now. It to me it seems that Germany is the only country that has done its homework, like personal therapy you go through. They did some process, in opposed to I would say Hungary, for instance, or other countries. In Eastern, what was Eastern Europe, that didn't do their,
their
process,
homework.
Or how would you say? And so it comes out now with their attitude towards the refugees,
but
Germany is open to receive them.
If we would made our homework, like you called it, why we have a Nazi party in Germany who is with a seat in the European Parliament.
But
how is it possible that we had a movement like Pegida, who raises up in 2 weeks 35,000 people who walk there in a march with torches, the Night of Broken Glass?
By the way, did you pay? See, I'm defending Germany now.
Yeah, so I'm going to defend Germany too. It's very interesting. No, I we can get involved in this, but I mean, certainly one aspect of it is the you're never going to get a society that's 100% pure without any neo-Nazis or right-wing or left-wing fanatics, as far as that goes. The other is that, of course, a lot of the neo-Nazi thing is coming from the former East Germany, and this is a part of Germany that simply, like our countries that were in the communist bloc, have simply not dealt with the Second World War and what happened in the Second World War. So, I mean, it's like. I'm sorry, I'm a Canadian, so if I make this comment, but I've lived here for 45 years, so I'm pretty Czech. But it's in some ways, you know, the attitude of these societies is a bit like retarded children, right? And that also applies for some very high politicians in this country.
They hadn't dealt as Germany has dealt. You know,
relatively speaking, Germany has done fairly well.
For instance,
I think,
I don't know if it's, but my mother always used to say the Austrians. She used to say, and excuse me, nothing personal, but she said, for me, Austria is, you know, it's erased. because they hadn't
reparations.
They hadn't admitted in anything.
They were occupied. In 10 minutes.
So she never visited Austria. Neither did I. I was never there. Excuse me. So you see, there are things. But Germany, at least they were trying, and they sent people, and they helped Israel a lot, and still do. But of course, there are neo-Nazis there too, and I don't know what to say about that. I mean, in Israel, we don't have that. At least.
No. Well, not no. Every country has extremists of some kind, some more, some less, I think. But getting back to a little bit, what for instance, nowadays, what is taught in schools about the Second World War and the Holocaust? I mean, you've got so many land, and they probably have slightly different educational systems. But in general, what do young people learn about the Second World War?
The Holocaust itself, it's about 4 double hours. That means 8 hours, and the Holocaust is done. So that's all what we're talking in school about, history, the dark side of our history.
Okay, and when they do deal with this Holocaust, what effort is made to try and explain what happened, or what context is this put in?
I give you an example. I was invited in a school, a very famous school in Germany, and the history teacher, a lady, very smart one, young one, came and pronounced who I am and said, this is the grandson of Rudolf Hess. So, Hess, who was the secretary of Hitler and later became the commandant of Auschwitz.
She doesn't know her German history, right?
So, that is exactly what happens.
Really?
Yeah.
So bad.
And then I said to her, let's go out to have a meeting between us. You have to clean up. And she said, no, tomorrow the students had forgotten it. Is that a way to educate youth? And I said, okay, if you not do it, I will do it. And she said, no, I don't do it. And I went in and I cleaned up the situation. And the next history lesson she never gave in that class.
Presumably in Israel, you know, the Holocaust is, in some sense, as far as I can observe from a distance, it's become more and more central in many ways.
It's part of our identity, if you like it or not, as we see it. There are debates on how to pass it through to next generations. I mean, can you hear me?
Is this working?
Not sure.
Yeah, they say it's working.
Sorry. How do we teach the Holocaust? I mean, the survivors are fewer and fewer. My mother is 92 and a half now. She's one of the very few who are left from that generation, and they're dying every day. And so what would be without them? Who will tell the story? How will it be told? Do we tell only the horrors? What do we take from there onwards? Okay, I can give you an example of one thing we do in the Terezin Center in Israel, is we use themes from the Holocaust in educational programs. For instance, solidarity. That helped at least the people in Theresienstadt a bit because they were from youth movements. So they were organized and there was more solidarity and it saved lives. Or seeing the other, you know, looking and seeing the other who is not like you. We do programs with Israeli and Arab youth. We take them to Theresienstadt and to Auschwitz-Birkenau, and we do mutual programs in Israel also around it. So that's one of the examples. You have to take it forward, and of course it's very, very relevant to these days in talking about, you know, seeing the other, not demonizing the other. But how do you do it? And this is something I don't know if you want to talk
sure.
about later.
No, we talk.
But, you know, in Israel, I'm not speaking in name of the government now. I'm not an official. I'm speaking only for myself. But at least half of the Israelis are trying, even though we are quite in a fighting position again with the Palestinians, and we are... We have a lot of terror around us for many, many years to try to still see the Palestinians and the Arab people as persons, you know. And if I have an Arab person sitting next to me on the bus or in a taxi, sorry, how do I not treat him immediately as a potential
terrorist?
Maybe because, you know, that's the automatic feeling. Is he going to do something to me or not? Is he dangerous or not? But he might be an innocent person. So you have to work on it, you know, and deal with it every day. It's an everyday labor. And I'm thinking of you in Europe now, not Czech Republic, maybe. Who knows?
But that was the experience I had in May when my oldest daughter married a Muslim. So I never expect that question. I told you that yesterday. When she came home and she said, Dad, I have one question. Can it repeat what was in the Second World War with the Jews? Can it repeat with the Muslims? Well, I'm married now a Muslim. So I was really shocked that my own daughter asked me that question. Then I said, okay, give me a little bit time. I have to think about it.
You mean the Muslims that will be the
next
Jews?
Yeah,
the next victims.
The next Jews.
Because I was thinking of the extreme Muslims as the perpetrators.
I always use some kind of projects to shock people. Mm-hmm. I like it to shock people. So I buy the book Mein Kampf, the biography of Hitler, which he wrote in the time in imprisonment.
It's the ideology also.
Yeah. Then I have a good friend. He's a, what do you call it, like a IT whiz. Mm-hmm. And we made a backslash behind the word Jews and put Muslim in. Uh-huh. And then I gave it to students to read it. And they read it. They have no clue what they read. And they said, oh, that's ugly stuff. What you gave to us? I said, that's Mein Kampf. Yeah, but Muslims were not in the focus in that time. I said, oh, you're well educated.
Good.
But it is exactly mm-hmm. what happens right now. And it is not, it starts not with a bullet. It starts with hate, with bad propaganda, and the result is fear. And after fear, we have new victims.
But I need to really separate something, because the Jews never threatened, as far as I know, the European community at large, while the extreme Muslims, they are threatening. I mean, the fact that you're paranoid doesn't mean that you're not sought after, you know?
But it is not.
People are afraid of the Muslims.
But it is the Islamic State. Like ISIS, mm-hmm. who
I'm talking about them
made the trouble. But if you listen to
but how do you know when you have an immigrant from Syria now coming to Greece or to Serbia or to France that he's really an innocent immigrant and not a terrorist? That's the thing you have to deal with all the time now.
But right now it is a propaganda focus. He is a terrorist. And in that moment, all refugees and all Muslims are terrorists.
It's a big dilemma.
But it is a dilemma, and it's a problem which...
You can sit behind a German, and he is also a terrorist. Like the NSU, the National Social Underground in Germany, were protected by our government. They killed over 10 years. They killed Turkish people, Greek people, a police lady, and the government protected them.
But I think the scope is a bit different.
I think the scope is different. And what I think one of the main problems now is that it's something that is it's built up, but it's suddenly taken on gigantic proportions, especially in the last, obviously, few days. And it's something that the same kind of irrational reaction is taking place in many, many places. I mean, this is why it's, I think, quite interesting. I would agree with Tal that, I mean, the immediate possibility of something violent happening is more in Israel.
Of course.
And so then...
But don't judge the book by the cover.
No, but the problem is then how do you fight against judging the book by the cover? I mean,
Hard work.
Okay, let's hear it. Yeah. Hard work.
Because
there's got to be a lot of this hard work in Europe now.
I'll give you one word answer and then we can elaborate. Yeah. Dialogue. Mm-hmm. Dialogue, speaking, dialoguing again and again and again. I, for instance, belong to a dialogue group with Palestinians, media people. We were arguing like crazy. We never agreed. They think we are conquering their land. We think they are not seeing us, etc. But already we see each other as people. I mean, I remember their names. I wonder how they are. they call me, okay? We, as long, I think Immanuel Levinas, the philosopher, said, when you look in the eyes of the next person, then already you are responsible for him. You can't hate him anymore. So you have to communicate as people, see their face. He said that in his philosophy. And I don't, and I think it's right. Even in this session, I mean, I already would treat Rainer differently because we met, because we spoke. Of course, yeah, and other reasons, but yeah, communication, speaking, dialoguing, even not agreeing, but, you know, seeing the people.
What do in your speaking and in your meeting with groups do you meet a lot with young people?
Yeah.
I personally feel that this is where the challenge is going to be.
So the age of students, the youngest group I had is the Stratford High School from London. These kids are 12 years old, and they're better educated than some historians. Mm. So the first meeting I had was on Skype. So they sent me some questions and asked me to give an answer. And then the teacher called me and said, is it possible to have a Skype meeting together? I said, of course. So we established Skype, and I saw all these kids walking around. And I said, when did the class is coming where I talk to? And the teacher said, that's the class. I said, ooh. I was really shocked to see that kids in an age of 11 and 12.
And they asked questions.
Wow, it was unbelievable good. So, and then I traveled with students to Auschwitz. The last group I had in April, it was a Swedish group. And it's always interesting to see when they are moving away from the tour guides. So it's a tour guide is a 3.5-hour trip. So, and then you know everything about Auschwitz? No. So they asked me and said, okay, we do it. It was 4.5 hours only in the main camp. And then the next day we spent the whole day at Birkenau. And I placed all the cruelty stories I had from survivors.
I have to ask you, as a person and a journalist, I'm always curious. Isn't it?
She's always got this journalist thing behind question she asks, right? We discovered that last night, right?
Double gene, double-sided. Isn't it so hard for you? I mean, isn't that
it
you
is
repeat
hard.
And deal with it all the time? How
do you feel?
I get up with the Holocaust and went to bed with the Holocaust. So I'm like in a 24-hour shower of the Holocaust.
And I have another question for you.
Yes.
Now? Just then, that's the last one. Then I can give you the back.
I'm not supposed to be
I'm just curious. How come you didn't change your name? I mean, it would be so much easier
It's a very unique question. Don't have it so much. I think it makes no sense to change my name. Why? Why I should change my name?
Because it's hard to walk in the world with this name.
If I went not public or do what I do right now, nobody knows who I am.
That's right. That's true.
So why I should change the name?
You could introduce yourself without, but...
My family has a very cruelty legacy, and they were proud of the name, so I destroyed that way as well.
Ah, okay. That's
it's
a very
like
good answer.
It's like a kind of revenge to show that I'm not... The evil is not inherited in the blood, like the Nazis always pronounce outside and said, yeah, we are the Aryans. Bullshit. Mm-hmm. Aryans are still not exist. And we made a good project, I told you yesterday, with a German Jew who went to New York. His name is Mark Erwin Babay. And his mom and his grandparents were also victims and survivors of Theresienstadt. So he made a black and white project with pictures. And after the actors in where I get photographed, we took a DNA test. We're only Germans. And it was unbelievable, the result. A lady with blonde hairs, blue eyes, very tall, looks like the real Aryan. She was half Jewish. Mm-hmm. And she said, no, I'm absolutely from North Germany. We have no Jewish blood. So it shows that everything comes over the Mediterranean Sea.
Nothing is true Aryan or true...
It was a myth.
A clean DNA.
It was a created ideology. And then a good lady, Mo Asumang, She made a film called The Aryans. And she went to Iran and met the Aryans.
Right.
And you see it in the film. She was really, really amazed that moment when the local people came out and said, Hitler stolen our identity.
You should remind that Iranians are from an Aryan descent. I mean, one should.
And they're so lovely, I mean, people.
They're not Arabic at all.
I was there 3 years ago.
I mean, all of these crazy images and so on. The Czechs are very lucky, by the way. DNA has shown that the most totally racially mixed group in Europe are Czechs.
Yeah?
They're total mongrels, thank God. I think because we did say that there should be questions from the audience and so on, I think but you're first, I've got you. We have or should have people in the audience with microphones. Yes, they're getting ready, I hope, yes.
I can lend you mine.
No, they've got them somewhere. So yes, we would like to have questions from the audience. If you feel like asking in Czech rather than English, it's not a problem. I can translate for those who need it. First, you were number one. You had your hand up before I even finished making the offer.
Thank you. I would like to ask Rainer, what's your explanation for your grandfather's activity during Second World War? What happened? Why he did what he did? That was his nature or some special circumstance? Or what happened? Why?
Good question.
What happened? Why?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So when it
because, by the way, I think that for everybody, these movies they are about stories from 40s, and this is a long time ago. But now we are sitting here, and you look like ordinary men, and we can see that. Okay, you are your grandfather was this guy from this screen. And you are directly connected to him, and that's why I'm asking you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I have to go a little bit back in time. That means the First World War. So he joined the First World War, and in that time he was on the Palestinian and Iraq front. So he protected the Jewish people in Jerusalem. For me it was a shock when I made my research, and I found evidence about it. Well, before I was thinking it was a story of mine sometimes. But it was the truth. So 18 years later, he was the mass murderer who exterminated the Jewish folks. So who was it? What changed his life? I have no clue.
I read that he was just trying to please Hitler very much. But of course, it's just
speculation. No, he likes to be the German mentality. Like, Germans are, in a way, if you make a meeting with a German, he came 5 minutes in front. Mm-hmm. If you make a meeting with the Czechs, they came 5 minutes past.
And with Israelis, 10 minutes.
So I think the Germans, they have a huge will and have strengths to deal with their life at all. So, and he was a believer in that we have enemies in our country. And that, in that way, and it was a good paid job as an SS officer, better than the Wehrmacht guy. And I think behind a SS man, a leader, is always a smart lady, like my grandmother. And she used, take the position for her own behalf as the commandant's wife. But I think there are so many tribes in that way which came together to fix him as the person who he is. But he was not a crazy guy, like historians always said, like a schizophrenic guy. On one hand, he was a mass murderer.
You mean schizophrenic?
Schizophrenic. He wasn't schizophrenic. No.
Like, and on Gering, who was schizophrenic? One of Gering? Who was crazy?
Good. I'm on good.
Of course.
But it was like a job. Like you went to build cars in a company, so it was to kill people. So he went out in the morning, kisses his wife, went to his job, kills hundreds of thousands of people, came back in the evening, put his uniform away, and plays with the kids in the garden.
You told me that your father and his siblings saw everything.
Yeah, of course. They live 100 meters away from the crematoria and the main camp. So you see on the old pictures They're playing in the garden, swimming in the pool, so they have a really luxury life and a very, very luxury area where they grow up. And on the back, you see behind the wall the chimney of the main camp. And when I was there with the footsteps team in 2014 and 2015, and I get them the chance inside to go inside the villa. So we went up to the second floor, and I said, "Now, make your own experience how much the family can see and saw in that time."
So I they would continue really this gentleman's question.
Sorry. It
you yourself in the same situation.
No.
It means that his character was completely different than yours.
I think I inherited a lot of things from him. Like to when you see my office, everything is on his place, and I hate it if people come in and destroy my system. Completely. I get mad if someone gets in my office without permission.
But you don't kill them. But
no, but, no, no.
No.
But Auschwitz, asked, but it,
Auschwitz
but
it, is the ultimate system.
Yeah, but it's I the ask me, system. I ask myself many times, but it drives me crazy. What would I do when I'm in the same situation?
That's why I said I don't envy you. I mean, this is such
a big
burden.
I think you will
burden.
Find no answer for that question.
You do your best, right?
Yeah.
But you describe him as a guy who liked his job.
Of course.
That is typical for many, for example, Germans. I think that there are many Germans and they like their job.
Unlike Czechs.
I think without doing that job, we had not that kind of genocide. And for me, it's always to listen. So we had the old people in Germany, they said, "Oh, I don't have anything about immigrants or refugees, but a small Hitler would be good sometimes." So I think that shows how they think in Germany sometimes. Not all. And that is why I think the new generation, my kids and my grandchildren, it will be a milestone in that way. They grow up in a distance to all of it. But what did they know in 10 years about Auschwitz, about the genocide? If we not teach it, it has not to be that we teach it 24 hours a day. But to remember it sometimes, that they know it was a big mistake. And it was not only a mistake by the Germans. So many other countries like Hungary were willing helpers.
Collaborators, sure.
So, I think it was a European stuff in that way. So it's not to glorify the Germans or say, "Okay, I get you out of guilt." No, absolutely not. But I don't know what I would do in the same situation.
Could I just ask you to make a comment on this or to comment on that? What? How do Israelis explain it?
The Holocaust?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, I mean, basically, Reiner's answer has been...
There's been so much written about it, and still, you know, it goes from one end of... there's this writer we have called Kacetnik, who said it was inexplicable. Some people say, you can't talk about it or explain it, it's another planet, to... Someone like, Yehuda Bauer, who says, or Hannah Arendt, who said the banality of the evil, mm-hmm. that you can explain it as, you know, just quite banal, as small people going and doing...
As simple as it was.
Simple as it was, and people in Israel were very, Jewish people were quite angry about that. And then you have, in the middle... People who I tend to identify more with, like Professor Yehuda Bauer, who is the chief researcher for Yad Vashem, who dedicated his life for research. And we won't get into all these reasons, from built-in anti-Semitism to financial reasons to political reasons. But he says one thing that I think I took with me is that you have an obligation to research the Holocaust, because if you say that you can't touch it or can't explain it, it means that you can't touch or deal with evil, with human evil, and it still exists on So we have the obligation of dealing with it and explaining it and researching it and passing it whatever we think is important to the next generation, which are you. And the question is what we pass on, of course, what values.
It's interesting, all that saying, basically, it's a question of trying to understand human evil, which has no answer, but it's something that you can
meditate on. But you know it's in there, and what arouses
it. It happens daily. Human evil happens daily.
Exactly. And then you talk about maybe the power of the masses. It's another aspect about the power of dictatorship and a dictator. All these elements we can talk about for... But one thing interesting I read is that... sorry. Again, from Yehuda Bauer, is that the three... dictatorships were kind of utopias, to presumably utopian ideologies. The communism, which promised a utopia of the workers' people's dictatorship, the Nazism, which promised a thousand year of the Reich. Judenrein world without the Jews, which will be perfect. And now it's the extreme Islam that promises a world without kafir, how do you say?
Infidels.
People who are Christians or Jewish.
Infidels. Yeah.
To annihilate all of them.
These absolute systems.
And yeah, and so systems. That means when they promise you and you put utopians like that, it means mass murder and genocide, finally.
By definition. Yeah. Okay, let's move on here. There was a question.
Peter Kalousek, I have one more question for Mr. Höss. I would like to ask if your family thing, or especially if your grandmother thought that your grandfather was a victim too after he was executed. I mean victim of new era or new regime.
Whether your grandfather considered himself a victim by being executed in 47, 48. I mean, did he go to his death completely convinced that, you know, he was a victim of these?
Yeah, of course.
Sorry, could speak to it? Sorry.
Yeah. When you read his memoirs, everything was wrong. He only follows order by orders. But that was 99% of the Nazis. They're only following orders by orders. But we found out that it was not following orders by orders. It was on their own behalf. If you wanted to deal or to work in a concentration camp, it was not a must. And you were not get killed about when you said no. The only thing you get blamed inside the SS for not to be strength and strong enough to deal with it.
So they saw them, like Eichmann in the trial, they say they were a little... nut or bolt in the system. That's all.
Cog right. In the system.
That's what he claimed?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he was a victim, yes. He was a victim too, no? I mean, it's... More questions? I can't see. There's a question here. And then you'll be next. More questions then?
I believe that the whole Holocaust ideology was based on... fear of people who are different and the fear that they might take our place in the world. And I see a parallel with the refugees because we are basically scared of Muslims because they are different. Are you in this context concerned with the Central and Eastern Europe governments in terms of spreading fear and, you know, supporting hate speeches in order to become popular? Do you see that as their failure? Are you concerned at all?
I think it's a...
I just want to... First, I really identify with what you say, a part of one point, as I mentioned, that there is a difference that the Jews at the time did not terrorize anybody in any country, but still were marked as the people, as the different people that have to be annihilated. And here, there are... some good Muslims and bad Muslims. You know, I saw the campaign now of 1.5 million Muslim people who hold in the Facebook and say, these people don't represent me. It's not me. But it's not the same because the Jews just live there, just existed.
Good and bad we have in all ethnic groups.
What?
good and bad we have in all ethnic
but
groups.
But yes, the Eastern European countries, I think, have to deal with this subject. Finally, they'll have to do something, I suppose, or all Europe will close their... I mean, Germany is thinking of maybe closing its gates, opposed to what...
Not closing the gates, only to control the income.
Okay. But it's still
it
more than all the Eastern Europeans.
But it came up after Paris.
No, it began here much earlier.
In Germany, it came up after.
Yes. I think that
the attack in Paris.
Countries like Hungary and Poland have to deal with their past. And one Polish very famous writer wrote about it, and I'm quoting him. He said that until these Eastern European countries will not deal with their past in World War II and in the Holocaust, they will carry the burden of their unsolved past that manifests in their attitude toward the refugees now. So one can agree or not.
Here, this question here.
Hello. Firstly, I would like to thank you for such interesting conversation you two had. I'm grateful for the opportunity to be here and witness it. But my question goes to Mr. Höss. I'd like to ask you if there was any question that nobody ever asked you, or because you visit schools and see students every day, they probably ask you the same questions about your grandfather, about the camps, about your family. Is there anything you'd like to tell us, share with us?
I think on the bottom it's always the same questions, which I receive. Why I not change my name? Who was my grandfather? So it's always the same. And I think that the time always is too short in meeting like this or events to discuss it. I need 30 years to know who my grandfather was, so I cannot explain it in 2 hours or 3 hours to an audience. So it's normal that people have their own questions which are interesting in that moment. But it's mostly the same.
You know, someone, we won't talk about it now, but I think your father's position was quite interesting and we didn't get, to talk about it. But he was in the middle of this. I mean, he was not a Nazi perpetrator, but he was exposed to all of it.
He was influenced, deep influenced by the ideology. So I give you an example. It was a story out of my youth. I had a friend in the neighborhood. And what I not know in an age of 11, he was a Jew. And his family also were involved in the Holocaust. So he had survivors as well inherited in his family. But he was my best friend. So, and after my dad get the info or were informed about that he was Jewish, in the evening he creates a sign where it stands on Jews are not allowed here inside and placed it on the fence door. So you know who my father was and is in that way.
Did this not create any kind of stir in the neighborhood? Or
no, they still accept.
Wow.
That was the problem in the 70s. Mm-hmm. There was no revolution about what happens in the past. And if people started this... Yeah, no, it is very simple. If people start a discussion, maybe they get pointed out as well. So what kind of history you have in your family? That's always when I met, 99% of the people in Germany I met are social democrats. Their families were never involved in any activities in the war.
So where did everybody go,
yeah,
right?
I said, yeah. Oh, you're the only one with your family. And you made all that stuff.
You made the whole everything?
Yeah.
No, people.
For these people, it is not possible to deal with the past. They have not the courage, they have not the guts to do it. That's why they call me a traitor. They don't like me. Well, I'm always
pulling up
that
stuff. But I'm sure many do appreciate what you do, right? Or only Jewish people appreciate it, or what?
Yeah, especially the survivors. So I got fear before when I met survivors. But one survivor who broke down the wall of fear in me, it was Zvi Moldovan. He was the survivor who travels with the students at Auschwitz. And he came along and said, you were not there. You didn't do it. So be aware about it. I said, whoo.
So he reminded you. It wasn't
sort of
you.
He giving cracks you, down the wall.
He gave you absolution, basically.
I think it was not an absolution, but he shows me the way how to deal with it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't carry that burden.
Yeah.
What you do is important, and do it on a, another level.
Speaking of burden, you know, the feeling, if we parallel here, I always had the feeling, and I think all my colleagues who are in the same situation as me, that we have the burden and the obligation of carrying the torch, you would say, onward. And I must say it was a relief for me that my children started to be interested and active in this as though I had passed it onward. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so I'm not alone in it anymore. The next generation is taking on this thing. And because mostly it's not easy. It's not something, I mean, it's a heavy thing that you carry. And so I think it is early for all of us, second generation, that the third generation is interested, most of it, or our children care about it. And we know that they do because they deal with it a lot and, you know, talk about it, etc. But I think I don't think about it anymore. It's part of me. It's so inherent that if you ask me who I am, I would say I'm a journalist, I would say I'm a mother of two, I would say I'm an Israeli and a Jew, and a daughter of a Holocaust survivor.
It's the same on my side.
Yeah, now that it's...
Thank you.
Other questions out there? Over here first and then over here. There's one over here, right?
So he's showing you someone.
Yeah.
My name is... Teresa Halová, and my question is for Rainer Hesse. I've read a lot about your grandfather, about the commander of Auschwitz-Birkenau, his career, his military experience during the First World War. And, for example, in the book, The Death is My Trade. And I would like to ask, there was another name, Rudolf Lang. The name of the same person. Can you explain it?
Rudolf Lang? You mean Franz Lang? It was his second identity after the war when he escaped. He was captured under the name Franz Lang. And he was a sailor.
Uh-huh.
Is this what you mean?
That. Yeah, I think so. I was confused, so thank you for your explanation.
Mostly of the Nazis changed their identity after the war.
How long did he escape?
He was catched by the British 7 months after they fled from Auschwitz. Mm-hmm. And he gave his faked identity, name. And they said, okay. And they helped him to get a job.
Wow. Well, I think.
And it was Thomas Harding's uncle, Hans Alexander. Mm-hmm. It was a special unit created by Churchill. And there were German Jews who fled 1938 to Great Britain and get immediately, when they came to Great Britain, they get arrested by the British. And later Churchill, he was a brain. So he said, okay, why we not use these German Jews? They know everything about history, how they deal with, mm-hmm. how they live.
The language.
Yeah. So, and Hans Alexander knows that the Germans had in their wedding ring the name of the man, the wife, and when they married, the year. So that was the only thing why they captured my grandfather. Well, there was no ID pictures, there was nothing. And Grabner, he was the guy of the Gestapo, the head of the Gestapo in Auschwitz, he asked him many times about the tattoo, which every SS guy had under his arm. And he said, no, I will have the whole family tattooed with the blood stuff and all. But it never came to a date. So that's why they have no pictures of my grandfather, no ID, nothing about him. So the wedding ring was the only stuff to capture him.
I remembered something interesting. Speaking of which,
but there is nothing in.
that when they tried to...
I learned out of history.
See, this is how you learn out of history.
Black humor. No, okay.
We're allowed, right?
You're allowed.
I read that when they tried to catch Mengele, I read in the, some Mossad people's diary, and I interviewed Rafi Etan, which was the guy who was in charge of the operation of catching Eichmann in South America, that he got communicated by this prosecutor, what was his name
again? Fritz Bauer.
Fritz Bauer in Germany, about Mengele, because he didn't trust the local authorities because they were defending their own at the time. At the end of the 50s, beginning of the 60s, they used to warn them, the police people, the security people used to warn the Nazis, and this is how they fled.
Mostly of the male Germans were in prison after the war. So the people who were left back were judges. So Adenauer has to use these people for the new republic.
Okay.
And he said, I cannot make clear water out of brown water. It needs time.
This is like all of these communist countries after 1989. They couldn't simply get rid of everybody.
The founder who established the BND, in Germany we call Bundesnachrichtendienst. Mm. So
what is it?
It's like a way of CIA.
Okay.
He was a full member, a full Nazi member. He was involved in the Operation T4 mm-hmm. action of Reinhardt. Oh, yeah. And he was in the Wannsee Conference, the final solution. And later became the head of the spy agency in Germany.
You know, I heard from Israeli commanders in the army at the 50s. Germany helped Israel with submarines and ships and the docks were full of German engineers who had a Nazi past, and the Israelis knew it.
Right.
But they needed the ships.
It was a
tool. So they just closed their eyes and took them.
It was a tool. Don't judge them. We need them.
We need them. There was a question here.
Yeah, yes. Here. What do you think about factory farming? That the same methods of concentration camps are used on everyday life.
Factory farming for animals. He's comparing it to concentration camps. Concentration
of course. But it was not chicken, it was humans.
Yeah, but it's happening now, every day. Like
mostly of, I think, people not know what happens. Do you ask yourself what happens with the ash after the cremation?
Ah, with the ashes.
Did you ask yourself what happens? Everybody said, okay, they were cremated. It was used as fertilizer.
Fertilizers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for the vegetable farm, which later gets back to the SS. So it was kind of cannibalism as well. And they shaved the hairs. They
ecological cannibalism.
Yeah, they used everything of that human being. From the teeth, over bones, over the ashes, the hairs, everything were used.
Skin.
So it is like an animal farm.
Back here, question?
Thank you. My name is Yasmina Heniova, and I would like to react on Ms. Bashan's comment about the Jews, that they just lived there. I agree on that. And I think that most of the Muslims also just live their lives. And that there is a certain group of extremists who twist the religion and they spread the terrorism. But most of them just live their lives and the hate of the people turns against all of them. What do you think about that? Maybe both of you.
I agree. I agree with what you're saying.
Other questions? The question is, where do you go on from there then? How do you keep that from spreading? And this is some of the things.
That's the challenge we were talking about.
The challenge we're talking about, how do you work, how do you educate, and so on. There's one question behind, and the next one here.
I'm curious if you consider this all this stuff like a closed chapter, or there could be discovered some more new information, because there were thousands of movies, there were hundreds of books, there left only few people who who were involved in this tragedy. What do you think?
Who are you asking?
Both of you.
How much more is there to be discovered?
Ladies first.
It's amazing, but I'm always amazed to see that the Holocaust still creates new stories all the time. We in Israel, as a journalist, every time there's a new page, a new story, a new discovery. Also, there is a big cadre of young researchers who are not survivors and not even Jews, who do a lot of work in archives and find more stories. I'll give one example. He's not a researcher, he's a journalist. He's well known in this country. It's Stanislav Motl, who is my personal friend. But he did a very important job in discovering stories about survivors, about people who helped Jews in the war. Now he is in Israel, for instance, discovered another hero that helped a Czech person who helped Jews during the war, etc. So I think with this kind of horrific drama that happened at the time, it creates endless human stories, and you know that we will still discover. I'm sure it hasn't ended at all.
And a lot of stories are untold.
Untold.
So I met a survivor in my last event. It was in Los Angeles in August. His name is Helmut. So he is a German Jew, and he told me after now 70 years his personal story that he was the runner of Auschwitz. I said, "What means the runner of Auschwitz?" Said, I was a 13-year-old boy. I have the striped pajama and have running shoes. I'm running between Auschwitz and Birkenau to get the messages from your grandfather to the head at Birkenau. A train is arriving, that they get back the messages. We have exterminated this and this kind of people, that scale of people. So it was a 10-hour day, 7 days a week. And I asked him and said, how long you stayed? How long you were in prison? And he said, 4 years. So he was quite fit.
But you said he never told his story.
Never.
And why?
I think I met him to prepare the next trial. So that was one of our opinion where we be in Los Angeles to meet the survivors, to get the power of attorneys. Well, in Germany, to bring people on trial, you need a power of attorney. Stupid, but you need it. And he was one in the audience. And then he came and said, I saw you talking to survivors and you're very active. Do you have time in the evening? So I came to your hotel. I will tell you a story which is untold until today. And I was really shocked when he told me. And it's a sum of what he said. The meeting with him was 7.5 hours. So it was more than last midnight, and he never stops with telling me what happens there, how he met, and this and this. And now he is one of our first survivors on the next trial. Mm-hmm. Well, he has so much evidence, not only in the story, as well in written version, in documented.
You know, I now remembered, one of the things is that these people never spoke. And now they are in their 90s, and they feel, it doesn't matter what side, also the survivors that never spoke because they didn't want to deal with it, that it's time to tell the stories. So suddenly you get these stories.
One of my closest friend, a survivor, Ben Lesser, who lives in Las Vegas, he starts speaking about what happens at Auschwitz when his first granddaughter was born. That was the point for him to open what happens with
exactly.
him.
One
before
things,
he was completely ashamed about what happened, so that he was not a human being, so he was not able to deal with it.
They really repressed it, many of them, but one of the things that opens up is the grandchildren, especially in Israel. I don't know if you have it here in the Czech Republic, that at the age of 13 or something, you have the special project, family project.
Right.
And then the grandchildren come to the grandparents and start asking questions. And somehow it's easier for them to talk with the grandchildren than with the sons or daughters. I can experience it myself. My mother
more distance between
told my children stories that I didn't know about.
Yeah.
because I think with us it's what's the word? It's charged, too charged. But with my children, they ask questions that I never dared to ask. They have no problem in asking it. Mm-hmm. Well, I was very hesitant. I was afraid to ask. I didn't want to make my mother upset, to upset her, etc. So they ask the questions for us, and they get answers that we never heard. And I think it's a very important process still going on.
At the moment, so about the information, I have collected more than 5,000 stories from survivors. And I checked them with the team, and 70% of them are untold. So what do you think when we dig deeper and deeper, how much stories we can get?
But the is time is running. Time is running.
5 minutes to midnight, isn't it?
Yeah. Really? So I was also invited by the Shoah Foundation. And as well, I was the first grandson out of a perpetrator side to saw the hologram vision of the Shoah Foundation. Well, they filmed it. It is called the camera ball. 250,000 cameras around the survivor. He is sitting in a chair in the mid. And it would film the survivor 7 days. So over 20,000 questions they ask him. And then they
sounds like
interrogation.
Interrogation, yeah. Basically,
yeah.
Right?
And they put a small, like a lens on the table and press the button, and you see the survivor in the middle of the table. You can walk around him. It's like a 3D, like Star Wars.
I see.
And you ask him question, and he said, oh, of course, let me think a little bit. And then he gives you the answer.
Oh, my God.
And it is like crazy. That you sit with him, and that guy was passed away 4 years ago. But it was a real good dialogue.
It's a bit creepy.
It's for our generation.
But I think that's the new level, to preserve all dead stories. And right now they have in their archive 500 survivors.
Wow.
I would say that it's very important that the young generation continue asking questions and interviewing. And we do that in our institution. We send the young people to be in touch with Holocaust survivors and write their stories, for one instance.
Yeah.
But still, it's sad to say that they're, of course, passing away because they're in their 90s.
That resource is drying up, coming to an end. We have, I think, time for one more question down here, or maybe two, depending how fast it is.
I just want to ask, we all know that the young people are so passionate and full of energy. So how do you do in Israel when you teach young people about Holocaust, that they are not full of anger and hatred?
Let me see if I understood you. How do we not...
When you teach them about the Holocaust, what do you do to make sure that they don't get the wrong message, i.e. that they don't
That's
end up
very
being
good question,
bitter, angry, and so on?
Because one of the dangers, and as we've seen it, is that in our case, the young people become nationalistic in the wrong way, you know, and see the Poles, for instance, as enemies or... And so there are a few things that we were thinking about. First is, I think, before the trips to Auschwitz and the concentration camp, there must be a very, very thorough preparation with educators, not to send them with the flag just to the camps to, you know, feel strong now. It's not the point at all. Also, me and my family, we feel that the Israeli groups should not be so, you know, open and outgoing there. These are places that you must tread with. They are sacred ground, okay? So I don't feel comfortable with the big ceremonies there, I must admit, but it's a personal feeling. We do emphasize, and I think, as we see here, that you have now to be careful that things like that won't happen again to anybody, not only from the German side, but from our side, to see the other person, to see him as a human being. And so I would think that with enough education, we, for instance, have about 3,000 students a year coming to our institution to learn about the Holocaust, but from that angle too. So this is what we try to do, and I think most of the institutions of the Shoah education in Israel, they're trying to do exactly that in order not to just, you know, release hatred and the, hatred of the other person, of the xenophobia or anything of the sort. I think it's important work to do in, I think, all Europe and in Germany as well.
It's a main goal. So and we all have to deal with it.
We would say that we were working together for that goal, each person in his own realm.
Which I think is a perfect ending. Thank you very much for being here, and thank you very much for our guests. Thank you very much. It was fantastic. It was really good. Okay. Wonderful. Okay. They'll keep on clapping forever if we don't leave.
Okay. Good luck.